I'm not quite sure where to start. I'm not quite sure. So open up in the first lesson, have a look at the first lesson, or just to share my experience with the folder and how I get to the first lesson, because I'm not sure how God is going to bring people. I'm not sure how God's going to allow you to meet somebody. You know, it could be as easy as one-on-one in a cafe and somebody being ready to accept, or it could be another way. And that's why I really enjoy the folder, because it's so flexible. It really is very flexible. One of the things that happened to me when I was in Emerald is I started talking to a counsellor. She was not an Adventist, she was not even a Christian, she was just a counsellor. And one of our church members invited us to hear a sermon, and I did a sermon on the glory of children, with Adrian done before. And she was impressed, so she wanted to talk to me. And she didn't want to talk to me about religious things, she just wanted to talk to me, how much she missed New Zealand, because she is from New Zealand, and she missed it. And I started asking her, okay, so what do you miss about New Zealand? I missed the family that I have in New Zealand. It's totally different in Australia. The Australian culture is totally different from the Maori culture. We're very, very united. The families are very strong. And there's a spirituality to the family that's not here, and I really miss that. And that was an opening. Yeah, that was an opening. And as we started conversing and talking, I started saying, well, you know, what you're actually desiring, did you know that is the original plan of what God wanted? And she started going, well, what do you mean? So, well, that God designed us, and He wanted us to be in family structures. And as a social worker, you understand the difficulties that families are having. Why are they having such difficulties? Why do you see such difficulties? And she started saying about the pressures of society, the education, and that obviously led straight into kingdoms. And I was able to introduce to her, well, have you heard of Abraham, the matriarch of the Jews? And she said, well, yeah, everybody's heard of Abraham. So, well, did you know that God used Abraham to give us a special message, to bring families together, to unite families, because they were split? And this is the desire that you're feeling, that the islander families have not been influenced so much by the European families, so you've still got that little bit of a structure still there, and it's drifting away. And she's going, well, tell me more. How did your European structure fall away? And I started saying, well, have you heard of a place called Babylon? Said, oh, well, of course, yeah, I've heard of Babylon. Have you ever heard of a guy called Nimrod? I said, well, no, I haven't. I said, well, look, there's a really interesting history about Nimrod and Abraham in what I read all the time in the Bible. And she said, oh, well, can you share that with me? This is, you know, over just talking, having someone to eat. She said, oh, can you share that with me? I said, oh, I'd love to share it with you. She said, okay, I will make an hour and a half every Monday available during my work area for you to come and give you Bible studies. And because I was able to connect her in that direction, she was able to say, okay, I want to listen to what you have to say. And that was the flexibility of the folder. I went straight from Abraham to Nimrod, straight to the first lesson. Does that make any sense? Throw questions at me. Just throw questions at me. If you've got, there's very experienced people here like Craig and Pastor Adrian and Gavin, you know, just jump in and say something. Yes.
Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
How did you get her to the place of sitting down with her to show her? How did that sort of dialogue and conversation go?
Because she was missing that structure of families. She wanted to see what the Bible had to say about structures of families. So that's exactly where I'm at. I started talking about the blessing of Abraham, started talking about the curse of Nimrod, And she, her interest was pricked enough to say, okay, I want to sit down and look at it and see it. Is that answer?
Yeah.
Because she was opening that direction.
So which chart did you go to?
So we were, sorry, we went to chart number 71. Now, we didn't do the study of it, but I used it just to throw things at her. You know, family controlled. You know, you're missing that family control. We were nomadic rural dwellers. Now we're all in the cities, and we're stuck with the government's looking after us. Where before our grandparents and our great grandparents and the elders used to look after us, and you're seeing from where you're working. The outcome of living in a city where the government is saying, I'll take care of you. Where the government is saying, I'll take care of your children. And because of her position as a social worker, she picked on that up straight away. And she said, well, really, is that what God wanted us to be like? And we said, yeah, it's exactly how God wanted us to be like. He made a special day even for us to remember that he was our God. And we quickly touched on the Sabbath. In remembrance of creation. So because of that line that she was going through, she wanted family structures, she was understanding what she was missing. In her job, she was seeing the outcomes of the society that we were living in, with all the drugs, with all divorce rates, with the parents leaving. She was actually interested in that aspect of it. And when God planted that seed, she was willing to study. And from there, that's where we went. First study, we went to straight where we went to now. Lesson number one. Chart number one. I started with trying to establish what her source of authority was. Everybody has a source of authority. Have we spoken about this before? So everybody has a source of authority. And I asked her, sorry, can we go page number one, establish your source of authority?
It can be a bit confusing. There's a bit of other information in between.
Yeah. So page number one looks something like that.
Very good.
Mm-hmm. Now, apart from a lot of stuff, I've just realised that my folder got a lot of pages missing. I've done a lot of Bible studies and I've just given the pages to the people I've studied with and I forgot to reprint them. But anyway, back to establish your source of authority. I always start there, and that's really where we should start. What is their source of authority? What is their oracle that gives them... their understanding, their knowledge. Most people today have two sources of authorities. One is their science, or the other one is family structure. What their parents believe, that's what I'm going to believe, or what science teaches me, that's what I'm going to believe. And you read relevant information on either one of those sources of authorities for you to make up a decision on what you would like to think. Does that make sense? Now, with the person I was studying with, I asked her for her source of authority, and her source of authority was the education system. The university she went to. Yeah.
Can I ask how you asked that? How did you frame that question? Did you just say, what is your source of authority? Or do you have a way of introducing that subject?
You can ask it in this way, do you have a source of authority?
Okay. Yeah.
It's simple.
Yeah.
Where do you go to and you know you're getting the truth?
Yeah.
So what do you believe now? How did you come to that conclusion on what you believe now? And when you have a question on something, where do you go to find the answers? That becomes your source of authority. Up until you're a teenager, your parents is your great source of authority. Once you become your teenager, then they don't know anything. And the teachers become your source of authority. And then they don't know anything. University students, university
do.
Comes your source of authority. Google becomes your source of authority. The world according to Google. So what is your source of authority? And when I introduce this, I am not trying to convince them that the Bible is the source of authority.
No.
I am looking at their source of authority, and then I'm introducing my source of authority. Mm. And you know that normally goes to and fro. Why I believe this Bible is my source of authority. I was there where you were once. You know, I was a very involved in science and reading books and all that, so I knew exactly where you're coming from. But now my source of authority has changed.
And so, you're not making the assumption that the Bible is the only authority. That could be interpreted as arrogant.
Mm-hmm.
You're actually starting where they are.
Yeah.
And then inviting new providing new information. So have you thought about this?
Yeah. And identifying with them. That at one stage I was exactly where you are, so I can empathise with your thought patterns and why you think the way you think. And then I brought into the mix when we have discussed it all, and I said, well, the items we were looking at, or the things we were looking at, they were spiritual things. We started talking about God, spirituality, how He put man together, how He put families together. Can we just take a step and saying, okay, because we're looking at religious things, can we just look at the Bible for our source of authority on these issues? Because we're talking about Abraham, we're talking about Nimrod, which we had already discussed, and this is where I've gotten my information from. And I'm not telling you, eat it, no? I'm just saying this is our source of authority. We're looking at something spiritual. And then we have come to an agreement that, yep, we'll look at this for our source of authority in this spiritual aspect. You want to say something? No?
No.
Okay. Throw tomatoes whenever you want. So once we can say, okay, well, if that's going to be our book, we're going to be looking at that. You can bring anything else into it, what you want. Any other book and any other religious book you want to, anything else that you ever read. And see how that answers the questions that you have. Obviously, the idea that you have these questions is because what you have read before or what you believe do not answer these questions. That's why you have questions. So let's have a look at this. Maybe this will answer your questions. And then it's an agreement on, yes, we'll start using this. And from there, you go into the folder and you can start pretty much... who do you say I am? Which is number 3. So have you heard of Jesus? Have you heard of Jesus? Mm-hmm. Who is he?
Good man.
A good man?
Yeah,
is a good man? Okay. Anything else?
Be a prophet. Prophet.
A prophet? Okay, so good man, a prophet. Anything else? Come on, you can answer these. Just let it flow. Let it flow.
Started a new religion.
Mm. Come on, you're Christians. Yeah. Come on, say. He's the son of
God.
Son of God. Okay, let's not try to forget about the elephant in the room, okay? He is the son of God. What else?
He could be
a madman. Okay. What else?
He's a person who died on the cross.
Okay.
For me.
Okay. So we are getting two very opposing ideas. Where do you get the idea of a madman, just a good man, etc.? And where do you get your idea that he is the son of God and he's not a madman? Where do you get those ideas?
By other people's beliefs, thoughts, or words that you've heard people in your past speak of, where they may blaspheme, use them as a call them a madman, or somebody who praises them. So you're opposites. So that's the sinful man who speaks roughly about him, or the man who praises him on the other side.
Okay, so what we've actually just established again is a clear understanding that where is your source of authority? Who has told you that he's a good man or a good religious leader? Who has told you he's the son of God?
Jesus.
You've just established your source of authorities.
So why do we go to Jesus rather than Daniel 2?
Good point. Okay. It's just a few steps further. To give you the perfect example of this, when I was teaching some 22-year-olds, 23-year-olds who want to know something about a specific topic in the Bible, I asked them, who's your source of authority? And they all said, we don't have a source of authority. We're free thinkers. What we read is what we believe. And then I asked them a pretty simple question. Who's Jesus?
Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior.
Amen. Amen. So I asked these university students, who is Jesus? Bearing in mind that these are all free thinkers and reading it off of themselves. And they said, well, in Sabbath school, we were taught, what was their source of authority? Sabbath school. So were they really free thinkers?
No.
No. So it was very obvious to see where the source of authority is. And not only that, what we're actually teaching our people. Did you read it yourself? Is the Lord impressing you, or is somebody outside impressing you? So if we're going to have a look at the scriptures from the very beginning to the very end is all about one person. And that person is? Jesus Christ. That's why we start with Christ, because it's all about Christ. It's called the Word, the living Word. And Christ is described as the Word.
So Daniel 2, though, you don't see that could be the focus as well?
It can be the focus, but you've got to come to the conclusion yourself is about Christ himself.
My reason for starting here was to reach the heart. And we were talking about this afternoon, about in the divine, I didn't know this when I put this, but in the divine pattern, the reason and the emotion, the heart, you reach the mind through the heart. If you can move the heart, it can appeal to the mind to accept the information. If you give information to someone and you bypass the heart, you can convince them logically that something is the truth, but their heart remains unchanged. Whereas this is inviting them straight into a relationship with Christ to be confronted with a person. Truth is a person, not just information, and that's why that's the main reason we started with Christ up front. Whereas typically in an Adventist presentation, Christ is held back and you're establishing confidence in the Word of God through logic and reason and analysis. And that's okay, but look what it did to our church. It's a very analytical, logical...
It's also can, to me, there's an element of fear put in it as well. Some of these prophecies where it's and I've got to do something.
It's a carrot, a based approach, like, well, the end's coming, I've got to get ready. Whereas this is a response to Ellen White saying Christ is attractive. Yeah. It comes straight to some point. But that's just some of the rationale behind, and it's the identity war model of a relationship basis rather than performance based. See what I know. I know all this about history. I know all this about Daniel. And there's a great danger of presenting yourself, whereas this, you're presenting the person of Christ. And so, for all those reasons.
I was going to say, Jesus came to set us free.
Amen to that.
So the personal aspect to what Pathway's been talking about is the question is, who do you say that Christ is? How do you get to that point? Not what somebody else is saying, but how do you get to understand who Christ is? And if I wanted to find out who you were, would I ask Pastor Adrian or would I ask you? Well, you would ask me. I would ask you. So if we want to find out who...
People no more.
As you would be as a lawman, you don't ask for hearsay evidence. You look for fact, and you look for evidence.
Primary witness.
So you go to the word to get your evidence and your fact, not hearsay. Hearsay can be 1 degree off or it can be miles off. So we need to stay with fact and with evidence. And this is what we've got, so this is a beautiful thing.
So we need to go and ask Christ himself who he says he is, not who I tell you he is, or who your parents told you he is, or who a historian told you he is. Where is the record of his life? It's in here. So let's go in here and let him tell us who he is. Yeah? Make sense?
Yeah.
All right, well, let's go. John 5:18. Somebody grab that one and read it for me. Yes, anybody just read it.
Therefore, the Jews sought the more to kill him, because he had not only broken the Sabbath, but said also that God was his Father, making himself equal with God.
So when you read that verse, what's it telling you about Christ?
He's claiming his Father is his Father.
God is his Father? And what else?
And that is also
that makes him equal.
Equal?
Yeah. So a son is equal to a father.
Son is equal to a father. So he is claiming to equal to God?
Big claim.
Big claim.
Very big claim.
The question has to be asked, who is God?
Jesus Christ.
And I'll leave it there until we continue, because all these questions have to be clarified from the Bible. So we will get there. Who is God? Christ claims to be the Son of God and equal to God. Let's go to John 3,
just before
36.
Go, just before we go, who are these Jews? So they must have known something. So these Jews challenged him. So they must have known something themselves, but didn't know his full story, I guess. So that these Jewish people who challenged him must have had a bit of knowledge or a bit of authority, so that would have been saying, well, so who are you? Yes, that makes sense, you know, they must have known something about him.
They understood the laws of inheritance.
Yeah.
But he's the son, then he's equal.
Therefore the Jews sought more to kill him.
Yeah,
just because he said that?
Well, yeah, you go back, as we know, into the conversation, you understand what it's about.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously the claim that he made is not very popular.
No.
Not in that context.
No. All right, John 3:36. Somebody read that for me.
He that believes on the Son has everlasting life, and he that believes not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him.
So as you read that verse, what stands out to you?
Believe on the Son. Belief in the Son.
Belief in the Son? Why is belief in the Son necessary?
Have everlasting life.
It's the bridging verse. First, before we're talking about Jesus and his relationship to God, this is talking about the relationship to everlasting life.
Mm-hmm.
If we would ever consider everlasting life, then Jesus is the way to that.
And if you don't believe in Jesus, you get no everlasting life.
So, have you ever thought that there might be something more than the current life you're living?
It opens up a whole world of questioning.
Yeah, especially for somebody who is searching.
What is everlasting life?
What is everlasting life?
Do I really want this?
Do you really want? Have you ever thought that there's something there? And if it is...
Sitting on a cloud playing a harp.
Yeah, is that your impression of everlasting life?
Well, that's
the source of authority for that view. It's usually paintings.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It is, eh?
Is
that what we're
going to
do?
Sure.
And the other one is rock and roll heaven.
Yeah.
Well, that's where all the rock stars go.
Where's that?
So, as you can see, the verses themselves open up so much for people who have never dwelt into the Bible, or people who know a little bit about the Bible, and people who are seeking. Just the verses themselves. Have you ever thought of eternal life? What is eternal life?
And again, that's a massive claim. That your life, your destiny depends on this person. What?
How can that be?
How's that possible?
So if you've thought about eternal life, the only way to get there, according to this, is how?
Through
a relationship with his son. Now that is a big claim, considering 99 of all sorts of authorities of today's planet tell you that you die, or you reincarnate.
It's interesting, the verse doesn't say he that professes the Son, it says he that believeth. So just professing, to have a relationship with Christ isn't enough, is it?
That's empty word, isn't it? Professing is an empty version. But believing is having it in you.
So within that verse, very clearly about it, him being able to give eternal life and take away eternal life, or not have eternal life. Because if you don't believe in him, you don't have eternal life. All right, let's go to John 4, 25 and 26. Gavin,
yes.
Would you like to read that?
The woman said to him, I know that Messiah comes, which is called Christ. When he has come, he will tell us all things. Jesus said to her, I that speak unto you am he.
So, in these two verses, who did Christ claim to be?
Messiah.
What's a Messiah?
The Son of God.
How would you define Messiah?
He's the Son of God.
The promised Redeemer.
Redeemer? Saviour? Redeemed from what? Saved from what? Does that not bring more questions? But yet he claims to be this.
Messiah is a Jewish word, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And what does that mean to them?
We'll look into it.
A channel.
Jesus. The anointed,
isn't it? It's the same as Christ.
That's the Christ. Matthew 9, 2 to 6. Ray, you can read a couple of verses and somebody else read a couple.
And behold, they brought to him a man sick of the palsy, lying on a bed. And Jesus, seeing their faith, said unto the sick of palsy, Son, be of good cheer, thy sins be forgiven thee. And behold, certain of the scribes said within themselves, This man blasphemeth.
But Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said, Why do you think evil in your hearts? For which is easy to say, Your sins are forgiven you, or to say, Arise and walk, but that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins. Then he said to the paralytic, Arise, take up your bed, and go to your house.
Once again, these verses, lots of things are apparent. What stands out to you in these verses?
Well, the question, what is sin? It says your sins are forgiven.
Yeah. What is sin?
The question, what is sin?
And why do you need forgiveness of it?
This guy can read people's hearts.
This guy can read people's hearts. That's, what else did he do?
He healed them.
These things are supernatural acts, are they not?
Mm-hmm.
I haven't seen anybody, I wish I had, but I haven't seen anybody walking down the streets healing people. It's not.
And he did it by his word.
And he did it by his word. So he's make what we're reading here are huge claims. Have you ever heard anybody in history that has been talked about like this? Does anybody stand in history that has been talked about like this?
I guess the only thing that relates to it is some of the mystical acts, I guess, of the, that they all talk about.
Some of the other denominations where they lay hands on people and they're all well. And
yeah, but it's also some of the miracles are performed by some of the saints and these legends that different people you hear in different pieces. That's the only thing that comes really close to it.
By saint, you mean saints of
Catholic Church?
Okay.
A Catholic,
sure.
Mary McCulloch and all that sort of.
Sure, but would you agree? Even those miracles, the power for those miracles are given to the supernatural realm, on which he claims to be the head of the supernatural realm. Because he has done this. All those miracles are done in his name.
My, I imagine my impulse would be as you're going through these claims that at some point a question that has to come in your mind, how do I know this is true?
Mm-hmm.
How do I prove this is true? And that's setting you up for the next.
That's right. So do you want me to move to the second one?
No.
Okay. So really, what we're reading here is actually bringing up more questions than it's solving.
Yes. Mm.
Okay. It's actually bringing up more questions. It's giving the emphasis on, do you want to know more? Do you want to know more? How can you be assured that what we're reading here is correct? And that leads to the next study, next study, next study.
That's awakening interest and
it is.
Curiosity and just, you kind of sowing seeds in a sense, aren't you? The questions that you're asking.
So a lot of people have heard about Jesus Christ, but many have not actually heard his claims, who he claims to be and what history says about him, and you want people to start to question, well, who is this person and how do I account for it? Is he just a good man? Well, he said he's the Son of God. And that's where you come to that bottom line where he's either crazy because he thinks he is these things and he's not, or he's a liar, he knows he's not, but he's telling us he is, or he is. They're the only three options you get. So you can't say he's just a good person when he's making these kinds of bold claims.
Yeah. And that's obviously the objective of the list of this study, to get to that point. He cannot be a good man, because if he was a good man and he wasn't everything he said, then he'd be a liar. It would not make him a good man. So either he was what he said he is, or he's a liar. We need to investigate which one it is.
And because the claims are so huge, for him to be correct, then it's got some more investigation to go to.
And the questions that are brought into your minds and are spiritual questions, a much higher type of question that you probably have thought about before. Eternal life, sin, why do I need forgiveness of sin, why do I need a Messiah, why did he even come, who is he, why did he come at all? And that starts bringing interest. Shall we leave it there, or do you want to first?
Right.
First study?
I don't want to keep going.
So I might just leave it there, but I'd like you to ask questions.
I was going to ask Eddie, it's that second study you come to, it's really the questions or the dialogue with the person at that point tells you how really the studies are going to proceed. There's not much questioning. Normally there's not a lot of interest.
And I found even this study, as simple as it might seem to us here, I've done studies with young kids who've been Adventists all their lives. I've done studies who've been with 20-year-olds, with 30-year-olds, and they have never actually thought about it for themselves.
Mm.
Who is Christ, and who does he think? Who I know what the church tells me, or who the church tells me he is.
But who do you say?
But who do I say he is? You know, it's the question that Christ asked Peter. Who do you say that I am? And only you can answer that. The church can't answer it for you.
He's the clean heart created in me.
Amen. Amen. Yeah. Yeah. So yeah, the first study is that. Yeah. Plant the seed. Get them thinking about things that they probably haven't thought about before. The next time you meet, that's the beginning of the dialogue.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what did you think? I thought about this and you said last week. Or do you, what did you think about? Don't be afraid to ask that. Because you want to show that you're as human as they are, that you have questions too. And then there's certain times that you might not be able to answer them, but you know what the answer is. And you can both go looking for it.
Give them some homework.
Well, that will come. That will come. Probably not the first lesson.
The second lesson.
If they start to read, that's going to be their own thing, because they'll just continue to go, won't they?
In the contents page, homework down the side.
Oh, okay.
We print out Bible studies, and they'll do the Bible studies themselves.
Okay.
So.
Yeah. So one of the things that I did is if they didn't have a proper understanding of lesson one or two, I didn't proceed.
Mm.
I didn't proceed. They didn't have to give their heart to God at that time, but they had to be able to understand lesson one or two. It's pointless proceeding unless they're still blocked to that. Would you say that?
Well, they have to themselves ask the question, who do I say that this person is? If they're not actually engaging that question, they're not actually looking. And if in the second chart, which speaks about the prophecies of Christ, if they're not actually willing to engage that process, they're not looking at that point. And it's not for us to manipulate them and force them to look. If they're not ready, then you just keep praying, but you can't force it with them.
And you've just got to work with, if they still want to have some dialogue, you've got to work with their interests. So.
Yeah, where it is. So.
But they've got to come back to that.
Yeah.
Who do you say Jesus is? They've just got to come back to that.
Because many questions, many times when I've done Bible studies, if you don't settle the Bible as the authority, most of the questions are, well, how do you know that's true?
Mm.
How can you prove that? So that you haven't settled that question, so you've got to keep banging your head against this question all the way along, and you're like dragging them over broken glass. It's a kicking and screaming episode all the way.
So lesson one introduces Christ, and introduces him as somebody personal. And it goes beyond everything that people normally known about Christ or have read or heard about Christ into something that becomes personal to you. Why am I a sinner? Why do I need a saviour? How can he give me eternal life? Why would he want to give me eternal life? And that's why I start with Jesus. Yeah, because those questions are the ones that keep popping up when you do that first shift. Is that what you wanted?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Awesome.
That was good. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Father in heaven, we thank you for a blessed evening. I really feel your spirit. I thank you for the presentations from Igor and from Eddie. We can spend this time together. I thank you for each one of my brothers and sisters here. Thank you for the love that you put in our hearts. We continue to pray that the agape of Christ, the agape of you, Father, will be manifested in our hearts, that this will become a safe place, that you then, through your angels and through circumstances connected to us or to others, will bring people here. Father, we ask you to bring people to this place. We ask you to lead us to people, to bring them to this place.
We ask you to help us, to show us, rather than focus on techniques and methods and skills to trick people into coming or to make them come to this situation. We don't want any part of those kinds of ideas. We just turn to you and say, Father, we want to share with others about your Son. We love your Son and we want to share him with others. Please lead us to people. Show us how to put surveys together. We're looking to you. You're the one that is wise. You know each person's need. You know this area. We don't know the exact needs of the people here. And Father, we know that your angels that excel in strength, they're eager to help us. And that they will help us and lead us to people. Let us be open to your impressions of who to speak to and how we could approach some people at these truck stops or at the fruit and vegetable store or many other ways, and that on Sabbath that things would open up and that our focus can be purely on outreach and sharing. And may we continue to pray, each of us here, each day, just keep thinking, Father, send us people, Father, send us people. The fervent, effectual prayer of a righteous man availeth not. And we hang on to the righteous man, our Lord Jesus Christ, and believe that you will answer this prayer. Be with us as we travel home. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.